Good evening, good evening, good evening. Welcome. It's a Monday evening and it is a blessed one because once again, we are gathered in this online auditorium to speak to yet another winning woman. Oh my goodness, what a blessed, blessed joy. It is to celebrate people while they are still alive and to just be the types of women who are able to take moments out in time and give honor where it is due, you know, and celebrate another person who is doing things that some of us can only dream about doing. And this is also that we can love on each other, but also inspire one another to say it is possible with Jesus if you believe and if you work hard. And today I have a very, very inspiring, gorgeous, smart, intelligent, amazing woman who I came to know as a pastor, but not only as a pastor, she became a mother to me and an inspiration in so many ways. She is Dr. Zoliswa Setsumo Mali. She's a dual citizen. She's coming to us. It's crazy because we've got a crazy time difference, but it's an honor that she took time out to be with us today. And so before I even go into your bio, thank you so much, Dr. Zoli, for making time to be with us today. Let me tell you who she is because she's my dog mama, but you need to know more than her just being my dog mama because she is so much more. So our guest today is Dr. Zoliswa Zoli, affectionately known as Zoli Setsumo Mali. She is the director of the African Language Program in the African Studies Center at the Pardee School of Global Studies at Boston University. She is also the president of ALTA, the African Language Teachers Association. Apartheid schools. She studied and taught at the University of Fort Hare, where Nelson Mandela had started his college education. She got a BA honors there and proceeded to a historically Afrikaans institution, the University of Stellenbosch near Cape Town. It is there that she got a master's cum laude in African linguistics. It is there that she got a master's cum laude in African linguistics. And she further went on to the University of Iowa in the United States. Am I reading this right? Oh my goodness. No, I don't want to do this wrong. She got a BA honors, right? And proceeded to University of Stellenbosch near Cape Town. She got a master's cum laude in African linguistics there before coming to the University of Iowa in the United States of America, where she got a second master's in linguistics and then further got a PhD. Okay, did you get that part? Two master's degrees, honey, two double grades, and then she got the PhD. She got her PhD in second language acquisition. She teaches isiZulu and isiXhosa, which are South African languages, and she teaches Africa Today. Recently appointed as a consultant by Disney filmmakers for isiXhosa in LA. So she was also recently appointed as a consultant by Disney World filmmakers for isiXhosa in Los Angeles, USA. There is so much more that we could say about Dr. Zoli Mali, but you know what? We're not talking about someone who's in a book. She is right here today to tell us all about herself. Dr. Zoliswa Setsumo Mali, a powerhouse, a kingdom woman, a woman who's making strides in the world, and our inspiration for the night. Welcome. How are you?
Thank you so much, Yols. Thank you for welcoming me into this space. I feel like I'm in South Africa right now. I'm at home. I am very well. I am very well by the grace of God. And I am even feeling better that I'm seeing you and sensing the people in the audience as if I'm seeing them.
God is so good. I need them to drop comments right now. Can you drop a comment and say, hi, Dr. Zoli, it's me. I'm watching from so-and-so, and I'm so blessed to be here today. Please do join us in the comment session. Tell us who you are. Tell us where you are. Remember, we don't see your name until you drop it in the comment section. So we would love to highlight your comment as you are watching so that we can see that you are with us. And also, kindly share the stream because somebody might need to hear Dr. Zoli's story and they might be blessed. So if you're tuning in, I'm asked to hijack your world for the evening. Just start a watch party or share and be a blessing. Thank you, Dr. Zoli. Let's not even waste time because your story is so manifold and it is quite a lengthy one. And I don't even want to like or deny ourselves by limiting you. I want you to just start by sharing your story with us. Who is Dr. Zoli and all the layers that make you you and how you got to be who you are today and how you landed where you are today. I know this might take a little bit of time to the friends and people who are watching today, but I want us to really allow her to share her story because there's so much, it's packed. And I will ask some questions here and there, but please feel free to flow, Doctor, and let us know who are you and how did you make it? Because we want to know how somebody gets 4 degrees in a lifetime when she's a mom of boys and a lot of boys at that, and she's doing all these other things.
Oh, man. Thank you, Yoles. Thank you first for the opportunity to share a bit about who I am. I will just start by saying I am who I am by the grace of God. Amen. And I will tell my story from humble beginnings so that nobody will sit there and think, oh, it's all for the chosen few or whatever. No, and everybody who trusts and believes that God can do things, they can. I'll start with me. I was born and raised in a village, Elalini, called Ezeleni, in King Williamstown, Eqonce. I was raised there by my widowed grandmother because my mother was working in East London, and it was not just me, it was me and my cousins, because our mothers were working, their mother was working in King Williamstown, called her Uqonce, and all of that. This grandmother is the beginning of who I am today, because it is through her hand that I was taught, you know, obedience, respect, the importance of education, the importance of fearing and worshiping God. Even as a little kid, we would walk across the stream to the church that was a distance from home with our grandmother. And we were taught various values of who to be, which are so instrumental in my life today. I mean, some things we take them for granted. Hard work is something that a person will be taught at home first. By the time the world demands hard work of you, you already know that. You know, we would wake up in the village and go to the river to get water before we go to school. Today, I don't know, maybe somebody would think that's abuse. No, it was not. It was proper upbringing, teaching you responsibility, teaching you hard work, teaching you that you need to get things together in life. My grandmother taught me other, you know, values like forgiveness, like just all sorts of things. There was no gender divide in terms of the division of labor in my grandmother's house. I knew how to herd goats in the village. I would be proud coming home with kids of a goat. I remember one time coming with twins of a goat, and my grandmother would give me all these alcohol leads. I'm mentioning this because from these little beginnings, a person is formed, and in the process, you will apply the same in your lifelong journey. And we were also taught politeness. You know, I grew up with boys. My cousin's sister only came when I was 8 years old. I had grown up with the others. So we would be roughing and tumbling with boys. And my grandmother would make sure that you know what to do or to say. For instance, you would even be punished just for saying, "We are talk." Today you would say, "That is this cause." No, you have to say, "We are possessor." You were told to say, "Thank you, Grandma." I'm mentioning this because as I deal with young people nowadays, these things are living our value system. And yet, that these are the things that make us who we are in the world today. So from there, I'll cut the village life. I wanted that to be there and move on to East London. When I passed my standard 6 back in the day, I don't know what grade, is that grade 8 or what today?
Yes.
So when I passed that in the village, I went to East London where my mother was working now because I needed to start being close for high school.
Yes.
So the long and short of it, I lived in East London and I would be commuting long distances to Mtanzane where my secondary school or high school was. And then we moved to Mtanzane. Even there, this issue of education that my grandmother had started inculcating in me was further supported by my mother. I remember how she would send me to a book exchange. It was called the East London Book Exchange. I would hop on a taxi, go to East London to go get books for my mother, to return books that she had been reading. And from that early age, I would be reading books. Some of these books, she would prohibit me from reading them. Then I would be cleaning the house. When I'm under the bed, then I'm reading a book. She does know that I'm reading that.
The Mills and Boone.
Do you know that? Yes, she had Mills and Boone and those comic books, this and that. But those strengthened my fiber in terms of reading. When I was in high school, I was winning rewards for languages, be it English, be it isiXhosa. Why? Because I had been raised by reading older people. My grandmother back home, she would be reading Pilgrim's Journey and all of that. And when she's not at the book, I'm at the book, I'm reading it. If it's not that, it's the Bible. If it's not the Bible, it's the hymn book and all of that. So they were training us because the Bible says, train a child in the way they should go. Even when they are older, they will not forget it. And I do want to highlight that's where I came from. And then about serving God, I will mention that this started at home as well, because I'm not only academia. Thank God for that. I'll still tell that story, but I'm also about serving God. It started at home. I remember when I fast forward, my grandmother was bedridden when I was in high school, secondary school at the time. She had a stroke, and I had to take turns with my mother to take care of my grandmother. So it meant if my mother is going to go to the main service at the church, I must go to Sunday school. Believe you me, I stayed in Sunday school, which is children's church where I am now, till I was about 15 years old. And generally speaking, I shouldn't have been there, but it was my mother's way of keeping me there so that when I come back, she goes to church, I take care of grandma, I do things that you would not think a younger kid would have done. What did that do? My Sunday school teacher realized that by the grace of God, I knew a lot already because it was done at home. And I had been sitting here in Sunday school for long. I was a teacher of other kids in Sunday school. So to me, that is not a little thing because it planted a seed of who I later on in life became. If there would be skits or sketches, as we call them at home, I would be leading in those at church. So there was school, there was church, and all of that stuff. I loved singing. I would be in church choirs and everything. So I moved there past my JC back in the day, and I needed to go to teacher training as soon as possible. Before I was 18 years of age, I was done with teacher training at St. Matthew's teacher training in Case Kamahuku, because I needed to come and help my mother. My mother was a factory worker. Don't be confused when I say they supported my education. They were not professionals, but they were sure that even though they are not highly educated, they are going to produce a professional in me. And they did, by the grace of God. So in St. Matthew's, even there, even though St. Matthew's is an Anglican church, I was taught that you don't pick and choose. Where God is worshipped, that is the house of God. Worship God and not say, I don't go to that church, I go to that one. So I was a chorister there and I was doing many other things. So I will move from there and say, with my mother's encouragement and self-determination, I started to do my matric. Now I'm teaching already. Remember, I said I passed the Form 3 and went to do PTC, which is Primary Teachers Certificate. I did my matric on my own. I am trying to encourage whoever would be here and say, oh, well, it's past my time. What can I do? I did my matric in record time. In 1 year, I took all the subjects that I needed to do and I passed. I was already a teacher in one of the villages. I would walk long distances. I didn't even have a car at the time. I would walk long distances from Matsibi, hitchhike to King Williamstown to take some of my classes and so on and so forth. And then eventually I moved on to Kongota, a village where I taught. There I went to what at the time we call the Forte branch, which is the Division of External Studies for Forte. At the time, it was at Zuelicha, and then it moved to Bisho. What was I doing? Acquiring my bachelor's. So I got my BA studying on my own. So we cannot be victims of circumstances. You have to invent and reinvent yourself as you move on. So I did my bachelor's again in record time. Mind you, by then, I am married because I got married in 22. I'm beginning to have kids. I'm beginning to raise kids and I'm studying. The long and short of it, I went on to Forte full time so that I could do my honors in 1 year. And by the grace of God, I was given an opportunity to teach there, because even as a student, I was always a teacher. If you see people in group study, I would be in group study and I would be teaching others. You know, we would be doing things like syntax, semantics, morphology, phonology, all these things that are not so easy with linguistics, which I was studying at the time at Forte. But by the grace of God, I was excelling in those. I was getting my distinctions and everything. And Forte noticed and they gave me the position. So after teaching 10 years and being a deputy principal in the villages, I went to Forte and I taught there. When I was teaching there, I got, like I said, I got my honors, and then I went to Stellenbosch part-time to do my master's, which you already heard that by grace, I also got cum laude. So having heard that, I think that was 1995 when I got my first master's. And I continued, there were many other things. I can't tell all these details, otherwise we won't go home. And there were many other things I was doing. I remember being engaged with the Phillips Academy here in the United States, because a delegation of teachers came to the University of Forte and I was requested to host them. And that began to open doors for me, because after I worked with them, I came to the United States in 1998 to work with them. And then when I came back to Forte, I was invited by the University of Iowa to come and start a program for them for teaching isiZulu. Remember, at Forte, when we would be doing our linguistics courses, by the time you are in course 3, you are doing a comparative study of isiZulu, isiXhosa, isiSwati, all the Nguni languages. And you also are doing a comparative study of the Sotho languages. So Setswana, Sesotho, and Sepedi, the structure of those languages, even though you don't speak them fluently, you know it. We were trained in that. Little did I know that that would be what would open doors for me. Mind you, when I was at Forte, I majored in English. I majored in isiXhosa. It is not the English I majored in that brought me to America. It is isiXhosa. So sure. I do want to highlight that and say, do not look down upon your own language. Not everybody is called for all these other things. You may be called for this language that you take for granted and stuff like that. Yes. And yours, at any point, feel free to interrupt and interject. I'm about to finish this long life story. So So in Iowa, that's for me, I came to do my PhD there. And then I was advised to do another master's first, which you all told you about already. At first, I didn't like this idea of coming here with my cum laude master's and now being required to do another one. But I do not regret, because it opened other doors. And as the Lord would have it, a year later into that master's, they started the program that I ended up doing, which was called FLAE, the Foreign Language Acquisition, Research and Education. So I was both in the School of Education and in the School of Arts and Culture. And I was doing technology and linguistics in my PhD as part of my second language acquisition. Whilst I was also teaching, and I was there with two of my three boys. One is there in South Africa, two are here. So I was busy mothering, being a soccer mama, having to go take Sia to his soccer games, go watch Sidima in his basketball games, or his running and everything, study and do everything. That's when I think I became a serious affiliate of Philippians 4:13 that says I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. If I can, so can you. So
I'm so encouraged right now, because I need all that academic grace, my God, and the mothering and the wifing, all of it, Jesus, I receive it.
And yes, we can. Yes, we can. So, when it was never easy, I will say that, because you know, when a person tells a story, it sounds like it's free flowing. There were difficult patches, but being in Christ made the difference. Because in all of this, I'm just telling a story. I'm not, well, I think I did mention that I am a reborn child of God. For that matter, I met Christ whilst I was at Forte. Whilst I was at Forte, being a lecturer there, I went to the SCO, the Student Christian Organization. At that time, it was SCM. For that matter, I had been an SCM member even at St. Matthew's, but I specifically accepted Christ from there, and that's what made a whole lot of a difference. All the other battles that a person will face, I mean, I told you I was married, and oftentimes, if the devil is still alive, there will be battles in that area. So I fought through those battles, and by the grace of God, I succeeded and came to where I am now, glorifying God all the way. So with all of this, I will mention one more thing. In all of these institutions, there would be, at St. Matthew's, I said I was a chorister, and I was in SEO. At Forte, I met Christ. I was going to the Assemblies of God, leading women in the church. I remember, if I would use Isixhosa, ndandingusihlalo womakoti, I was the chair lady of younger women, and of older women and stuff like that. And then I came to Iowa. Whilst there, besides all this academic stuff that I'm telling you about, I was also seriously involved in serving God. That's where actually I got ordained as a minister to teach and preach the word of God at Gospel Explosion Ministry back in the time. So whilst I was there, all of this was going together. If the Bible says, let it grow together, I like it in Isixhosa, when things go like that, God is always in the helm of things and directing. And I said that at the beginning, I am who I am. I am where I am by the grace of God. I think I could put a little comma there so that y'all can ask and I can further whatever she wants me to say.
One of your favorite scriptures, I remember back, there was a phase where you came back to South Africa and you stayed a couple of years. I'm so grateful for that period where God brought you back from the States. I think you had been in the States for 8 years at the time when you came back, or was it a bit more?
I had been in the States since 2000, and I came home in 2011 to come take care of my sick mother now. So I was there from June 2011 to June 2013. And it's in that period that I served at ARC Christian Center as an in-house pastor. And I met you. And I would come to your business, and you would make me all nice and beautiful with you.
Client, buying everything I sell, every service, nails, hair, weaves, my number one supporter in ministry and in business, and just a lover of my heart. And I love you so much for that, and just for who you are. And I always say to you, like, I'm so grateful. I know the circumstances that brought you back were not great, but it was also great that you got to spend that time with Umakhulu. But I gained in Ndiyambulela ukuba ubasazuza, because I say sazuza nathi, you know, in that experience, because I never would have met you had that not happened. And I'm so grateful to God for that. The 2.5 years, it actually felt like much longer, because we spent a lot of time together. And yes, one of the favorite things that you always said, maybe if you're running a little bit late, or if you're running a little bit late, or something good happens, and then you'd always say, "Well, y'all's ama kosha etu asizandeni inkosi inkosi, the hands of the Lord." And that being one of your favorite scripture, and also somebody who might be saying, "Oh, yo, she has such a great life story. My goodness, why can't my life be like this?" One, I want you to take note before I ask my next question, that she says that she was raised with the values of hard work. It was instilled in her. She also acquired skills of being an avid reader. So she had a skill of being a student and enjoying study. So we have to develop these skills. Nothing comes easy. No one just wakes up, you know, with the desire to get a PhD, and then it's easy and it falls on the plate. You have to work for these things. You train yourself, you get the skill. And I can tell you, it's not easy if you didn't grow up reading a lot or around a family that has a library of books. So you want to instill these values in yourself and pursue what you want diligently. But at the same time, we, as much as we work hard and we have these great skills, it is God who brings us into opportune seasons and helps us connect to divine opportunities. And our prayer is that our opportunities would find us ready. But Mama, I want you to speak just to encourage people on trusting God and his timing, you know, just trusting God and his timing. Because you're saying, people came to South Africa, you hosted them, the next thing you're going on an exchange program, and then the next thing you're hired, and your life just fell into place. And now you're you didn't mention this, you're a permanent resident in America now. You're a voter in America.
I'm a citizen, actually.
You're a citizen. That's incorrect. You're not a permanent resident, you're a citizen. You're a dual citizen of both America and South Africa, and you vote, you contribute to the life of America in every way. And so the whole thing of trusting God and trusting his time, though we have plans, can you just for a few minutes just speak to that and encourage someone?
Yes. Thank you, Yols. That is the big part of what has happened in my life. I will say that and put in a few anecdotes. This verse that you have used is one of my favorites indeed. I am laughing because people would think I'm using it just because I'm not early when I'm supposed to be, and yet it permeates my life. There are things that do not happen at the time you had wished for them to happen. AmaXhosa have this phrase, I will say it in isiXhosa. UThixo ungumanga kubi kanti kulungile.
Kulungile. Hey, my God.
You know, with God, it looks like things are haywire. Things are going a downward spiral, only to find, no, he is re-engineering your life and redirecting it. I remember in Alice where I used to work one time, I had a dream. And I saw this beautiful house that seemed to be, you know, somewhat hanging, because it was up there in a mountainous place with a forest. In my understanding, it looked like the way to Hogsback, if you know Hogsback. And I was wondering, how does a person get to that house, which is so much out there? And I heard a voice that said, I'll say it in isiXhosa because that voice was in isiXhosa. Indlela enyukayo iqala ezantsi. The way up starts at the bottom. And as I heard that voice, I began to see a winding way, like it's the tar road as you know it, but it's winding. But eventually now I was seeing that it is possible to get to that house. And I feel that was God's way of dropping a nugget to say, why is it that your life seems like it's unraveling? There are things that happen. I mean, I told you I was married at 22, but by the time I left South Africa in 2000, I was not married anymore. What is that saying? You would say your life has just come to an end. No, it did not. But God was allowing it to be re-engineered sometimes. I mean, it's not hunky-dory all the time. And so there is no reason not to state all that forms who I am, because those struggles taught me to kneel and get closer to the feet of the cross. Those struggles taught me to pray and be closer to God and listen and know what God is saying to me about my situation. So each step of my life I took because I believed that I have prayed and I know what God has said. So I want to encourage somebody and say, never give up. Tell yourself giving up is not an option. And if you feel like life has dealt you a raw deal and you feel like things are going downwards instead of upwards, don't worry. The way up starts at the bottom. Sometimes you think you are being thrown down only to find you are being given an opportunity to start afresh so that you gain momentum as God takes you up. And this happens at different times. Like I was saying, here I was in the States. Little did I know that circumstances would cause me to go home. My mother is sick and I feel I want to be there and feel like I have handled her myself with my own hands. And I got to teach at Fort Hare again. I got to teach at Fort Hare in East London. And I met people there, students that are still connected to me, some of them now, and God made a difference in their lives. Just like he also saying, sometimes you feel like, am I moving backwards? No, God is doing something else, but he has ways of doing things that are not necessarily our ways. Sometimes you think it's ending and it's not. It is only gaining momentum to take you further. So that's what I would say to encourage people. Faith is what will take you everywhere. The Bible says nothing is impossible with God. And the same Bible says nothing is impossible with those who believe. So if you believe, you will know that you know that it can never be the end till God says so. If he has not said so, even if it's difficult, keep moving. I know I was a student. It was so difficult, but God, I got through it all. And I don't know. I don't want to be preaching now. I just want.
I love it so much. We're here for preaching. Amen. what can we do? We are children of the Most High God. The word just bubbles out of us. We can't help it. I always find myself, sometimes I'll be in a professional environment, and I'll hear myself say, amen. And I'm like, oh, I didn't realize I was not preaching today.
I have found myself doing that. There was something I was doing with my students. We teach with Zoom now, that I was doing not long ago. And I found myself saying, the Bible says, and no, the story in this book.
Oh, how we love that book, the Bible. Oh, my word. And the author of it. And Mama, let's just step back. Look, you are an academic. That's where you work. That's your love. That's one of your strong passions. And it's what has opened all of these doors for you. You know. And I want you to just encourage, really, really encourage, Black women to go into academia. I know I am. Like, I have dreams to be Dr. So-and-so, but oh my goodness, sometimes I'm like, oh Lord, is this really my portion? And then I remind myself that it's so important for us to form part of the, you know, of those spaces to affect and influence in academia. We know that there aren't enough Black women in academia, not only in South Africa, globally. There is a shortage of Black women in academia. And this is not to say, and by academia, I really mean in academia, not just women who have the qualifications and they go into corporate. That's also needed and that's important. But to have Black children actually see Black women and Black men stand in front of them and teach them, it does something to your mind. It just, it encourages you. It says, you know, you can. And as a result, I still am in touch with almost all my Black lecturers, male and female, because they make a different mark in your life, but there aren't enough of them. And I think it's so important that I don't let you go today without you really just encouraging the need for us to go into academia, the need for us to study, the need for us to be present in universities, the need for us to be professors. And by the way, Dr. Zoli is a professor. She's not just a doc, she's a professor. She is producing students with doctorates and masters. And, you know, she's the director of a whole program there in Boston University. So she's heading serious, serious business in academia. And so as a doc mama, can you speak to us as a prof mama on the importance of us affecting and being in those spaces?
Yes. And before I get into that, just because you mentioned Boston, I thought maybe let me start by quickly adding, because I didn't go too much into that. I just highlighted Iowa. I will just mention that I finished my PhD in 2007 and I got this position in Boston. And at the time, I was hired in two schools, which in South Africa we call faculties. At Fortier, okay, we say Faculty of Education. Here we say School of Education. And I was also in the CAS, College of Arts and Sciences. And at the School of Education, I was teaching what they call CALL. When we started here, Yols was saying, oh, I so admire how you are nimble with technology. and I was like, I thank God for having that opportunity, because I allowed myself to take the difficult part, because when I left Forte, I was not savvy with technology at all. But then I allowed myself to be trained in that. So I taught at the School of Education as a clinical professor, teaching CALL, which is Computer Assisted Language Learning. And in CAS, I taught at the African Studies Center, which is where I am, yours just mentioned now, teaching African languages, teaching isiXhosa, teaching isiZulu, and teaching the course she mentioned, which we call Africa Today, which cuts across Africa, various things, be it culture, be it economics, different things that affect Africa, so that these students from here who want to do further studies about Africa, anywhere in Africa, they kind of have a window into what Africa is all about. Many a times, our stories are told by others because we are not there in the arena. And now it comes to what yours was saying, encouraging others, because now I am a senior lecturer and I'm a director in that same university. I am encouraging others, step out there, take whatever you feel, this is my niche, this is my strong point. Sometimes you don't even know. When I left South Africa, what I knew at the time and I thought I wanted to do, I was tired of teaching pure linguistics. I wanted what I knew to be applied linguistics. Little did I know that another door that I didn't know about would open when I came here, which is the flair that I was talking about, foreign language acquisition, research and education. So the point I'm making, be what shall I say, have your antennas open and take opportunities. Do not be a coward. In the Bible, there is something said about cowards. I don't want to say it, but I will. There's something about cowards not going to heaven. So you are a child of God, you cannot be a coward. Allow yourself to get out there. Allow yourself. It's difficult, but it is doable. I'm holding myself from telling another story of a dream where I was going up a hill and I was seeing thorny trees, iminga, mimosa trees, and I didn't know how am I going to go up there. But I started walking. The minute I started walking, oh, this was not feeling as steep as it was. So I say to you, start doing it. I'm thinking the book I have here that I'm writing on, can you read? Start by starting.
By starting.
By starting. There's no other way. You have to start something in order to be able to get somewhere. And do not look down on what you are. Here's a primary school teacher who ended up being an international university. And I've not only taught in Boston, during summers, which are winters in South Africa, I've taught in different universities. I've taught at the University of California in Los Angeles. I have taught in the University of Florida. I have taught at the University of Indiana, besides Boston University. And even now, I serve some of those universities where I am. What am I saying? If it can happen from this little girl from Ezeleni, Elalini, it can happen to you. You can do it too. Nobody cannot. With Christ, all things are possible.
Amen. And I think you already touched on the question that I was going to ask Ness. I was going to say, in fact, what I was going to ask you to talk to Ness, I was going to say, can you now, just now that you've told them the importance of affecting and taking the bold step, starting to pursue these dreams and the things that we're passionate about and pushing ourselves to be in those spaces, can you talk about actually taking on the world? Because who would have thought, you could have said no to the opportunity to go to the States. You could have said, oh no, that's not for me. The right up is Lalini, the right up is Forte, the right up is East London. This is the life I know. This is where I was born. My kids are here. My kids are young. I won't go. And I mean, you had three kids and they were very young at the time, right?
Yes.
And
yes,
a lot was happening in your life. And you could have said, it's too much. It's too much to uproot my whole life and go abroad. I'm not going to do it. Just the thing about taking opportunities and not thinking that your opportunities lie in South Africa only, if you're in South Africa, if you're in another country, to not think that your opportunities are only in that country, you know. Maybe just, you touched on it a little bit, but can you just give us a little bit more? I know you're always full of encouragement.
Glory to God. Yes, it is true. Whilst we get our roots and our foundation from home, because in all of this, I do not undermine my own roots. South Africa is very important to me. Hence, yours was saying, I'm a dual citizen. I am a citizen of South Africa. I am a citizen of America. So I do want to say, sometimes, I'll say it in isiXhosa. There is iqhalo, or an idiom that says, indugu entle ikhiwa ezizweni. Indugu entle ikhiwa ezizweni. You have to take some strides and leave your comfort zone for you to get a beautiful stick. Now I'm paraphrasing this idiom almost literally. So for you to get a stronger and you know, get into higher heights, you have to fly out of the nest. By that I mean out of the comfort zone, out of the stuff that you know. Go to a space where you do not know, and you will be surprised. You know, I will tell you, because you asked. When I was about to leave Forte, I did have some level of ambivalence, and I did have a little skepticism here and there. I remember talking to the then vice chancellor of the university, Professor Derek Swartz, and when I told him the opportunity that I was given and the hard patches that I might have, he said, take a giant leap of faith. You do not know what the future holds. Go and think about this and come back to me, because I was not sure if I can get A to connect to B, how am I going to do C? He said, go and think. And when he said, go and think, I didn't just go and think, I went to pray. And the Lord put in my spirit the scripture that says, Abraham, it was in his cross, in my spirit, O Abraham, wahamba. Abraham left his country of birth and went to where he didn't know. All he had was faith in God, which was later counted to him as righteousness. So when I went back to Professor Swartz and said, yes, I am taking this opportunity, I'm cutting that story short because it has another trajectory to it. I said, fine, I will take it, because it was tough. It was tough. He was advising that I resign. And when I had gone there, I did not want to resign. I wanted to take what was called staff development at the time. But because he was beginning to do restructuring, it was not sensible to allow somebody to go and leave and be paid whilst they are away. Now I'm leaving my lecturership and my show salary. I'm resigning from a position to go to a country I know nobody in, only God. Yeah. And God said, Abraham left, he knew no one. And I decided I'm going to go. And guess what? God has been faithful. If you are listening and you are a child of God, I'm telling you, God is faithful. God is faithful. God is. If you forget everything I've said, remember, God is faithful. Just trust him.
God is faithful. God is faithful. Abraham left his home, took everything he had, and went to a land that God would show him. He just trusted God. We just have to trust God with our lives. We just have to trust God. Yo, mama, I have no words. I have absolutely no words. This is why you are one of our winning women, because you teach us all these ways in which by God and through God and hard work, we can win. It's not a one-day thing. What your story shows us is that winning is not a thing you wake up today and tomorrow you overcome. It's a process. It's a journey. And listening to these dreams that you keep having, these prophetic dreams where God was almost just always communicating with you that your life is a journey. You just have to take the steps. And as you take the steps, you overcome the thorns. You overcome the hill doesn't feel so steep anymore. And that says to us that we too, watching and listening today, just have to start. We just have to take the first step. And who knows what opportunities will lay ahead. We just have to equip ourselves, ladies. We have to equip ourselves. Let opportunities find us ready. Let opportunities find us equipped and prepared and, you know, and brave and trusting God to step into them. And that is me handing over to you, Mama, to close these last 10 minutes. Just speak from your heart, no question imposed, just what you have to say to these women about winning, about being a woman, about being in God, whatever the Lord has laid in your heart, it's over to you. I will step in the last 2 minutes and just come and close, but over to you. You'll see me when I come back on screen.
Glory to Jesus. Okay, what I will quickly add to this story is to remind us that we are triune beings, just like our Father is. So we have these bodies, and we have souls, which are our feelings and our intellect, and we have the spirit. So we are the spirit, we live in a body. So why am I mentioning this? We need to take care of all these levels of who we are. And in this year, 2020, that has been difficult for everybody, where we have been shut in and doing lockdowns and whatever. There are a couple of things that I want to mention that have been helpful to me that I can call successes. I will start with the base one, which talks about the body. Those who follow me in social media, they see that I keep posting my crowns and wins and everything. For what? Just for walking and jogging. I want to make that an important part, because the brain will work better and emotions will be controlled better when our body is stronger. If you heard, I've taught 10 years there, 10 years there, 10 years there, 13 years in America now in teaching, besides the 7 years I was a student. But I am as fresh as they come. Why? Because I decided I am not going to let myself be a go-go. I am going to be on the go day in, day out. We have these smartphones. I am advising those of my age and younger. Let us not be sitting down just because we are in lockdowns or whatever. Let us step out there and walk. If you say, I don't have money for the gym, you don't need the gym to do that. You just need your feet. You just get out with your feet and walk. So I signed up on my Samsung phone for what they call Samsung Health. And there I joined challenges with different people I don't even know, women from Asia, women from elsewhere. And I walked. walk, walk. Even now when I finish this, I'm going to go walking. Even before I did, in the morning I was in Bible study for my church. Whilst doing Bible study, participating fully, I am walking. So that the temple of God, which is my body, is kept healthy and strong. And I want to encourage you with that as well. I didn't start here. I did that even when I was at Forte. I remember some students that would wake up with me at 5 a.m. We go and run around Davidson Stadium. And then I go on to a prayer in the morning, now talking to the spiritual part of ourselves. This year, another win that I will call a win by the grace of God for myself, which I want to encourage you that there is no thing as saying COVID-19 has cut us short. We can cut it short too. March is my birthday. And from March, I agreed with the Lord that I'm going to start an hour of prayer for women every Saturday. And from the 21st of March, which was my birthday, till today, every Saturday, we have a prayer, and God has been doing wondrous work there. I go to a church, most of my sisters there are from Kenya or Tanzania and stuff like that. I have South Africans who join me there. I don't even want to name people's names, but I have people who are there at home who join me. People from other states, we pray. We have prayed for this COVID thing. We have prayed for our elections that yesterday came out like a blessing, and we were grateful because we have been praying. I am saying this to encourage you. Be strong in the body, be strong in your soul, be strong in your spirit. By doing all that it takes, study, encourage your inner man by studying the word as well. Be renewed in your mind by focusing on the word of God and being a prayerful woman and training and training. You know, even I'll call it a success even in my program that I direct, because it has not been easy for everybody to be thrown at the deep end of having to use Zoom and teach remotely, which is not what we have been doing. Not everybody has been trained with technology, but I will call it a success because we were able to support others and encourage them. And we have students who are flourishing. I just want to say all things are possible. All things are possible when we trust God. I love you with the love of the Lord. I hope this does it, not unless y'all feels there's something else I left out.
It does it, Mama. It does it. We must get healthy. We must get strong. We must work hard. We must get educated. We must take opportunities. We must trust the Lord. We must yield to the Spirit. We must just do. Your book says start with starting. Start Amen. By starting. And so we are going to get started. If we are not already doing these things, queens, we are going to get started. Just because it's November, it doesn't mean that it's, that's the calendar. Let the calendar keep counting. Our lives are not over. The year might end, but our lives don't end when the year ends. So we start even in November, even in December, we just get started. If you want to study, get online. There are universities that don't close for postgraduates. Start applying and you never know what opportunity you might. And some universities allow for you to enroll in the second semester. Take a leap of faith, like her vice chancellor from Forte said to her, Dr. Zoli, when she was anxious and she didn't know what to do. And the advice she was given was, you know what? Take time to think, but also take a giant leap of faith. That has been your whole life, Mama. And it is so beautiful to see a woman of faith who today is a testimony that faith brought forth fruit. Today, you speak of faith because you have seen the results of faith. You have seen the fruits of trusting God. And today we sit back on these online screens and we hear and marvel at what the Lord has done. We thank God for your life. And I pray that He keep doing more and more and more. We can't wait to hear more about what you're doing with Disney and what that brings forth. You are such a marvel. And I take joy at seeing what God is doing in your life. I love you so, so much. And thank you for tonight. Thank you for every word uttered. It has been inspiring. It has been not just inspiring, awe-inspiring. And yes, I know every single person today is blessed. So thank you for the comments, for the love, for the likes. Please share again and invite someone, tag a friend to come watch this. And I hope that they'll be blessed. I love you all so much. From me and Dr. Zoli, good night and God bless. Good night,
thank
Mama.
You. Thank you. Love you, love you, yours.
Thank you, Mama. Bye.
Amen. Bye, my dear. Bye, everybody. God bless you.
So it's been epic. That was day 7. Please don't forget, tomorrow we are back with one more speaker for, we are back with another speaker, but we finish off on Wednesday with our last speaker. Tomorrow we've got another local queen, proudly South African, who is doing great and amazing things. And on Wednesday, we cross over back to the United States of America again for yet another doctor, Rev Dr. Danielle Brown, who is going to be speaking to us and also inspiring us. We've got two more inspirational powerhouses. Don't miss it. Tell a friend, tag a friend, share, bless somebody. And remember that you are a house on a hill whose light cannot be hidden. It can't be hidden. The only person who can hide it is you, because God has trusted you with your destiny by giving you willpower to take brave and bold decisions. So use that power with wisdom. Light up the world and flavor it up with the salt that you are. Be a blessing in all that you do. I love you so much, fam. Good night and God bless.